spoke quietly, then it should cause everybody to move forward. So I'm going to speak. You know, you know better than that. That's the reason I have a mic. I do believe they should work. We're going to go to John 13, 14, and 15. No, we're not going to dissect every word there. So don't get too worried. It'll probably be done in time for lunch next week. When you consider Jesus' ministry, and you consider the words of the Apostle John, I'll give you a hint here. You can look at it either way. What is John's favorite word? I know it's early. It's not noon. If you had to guess, what is John's favorite word?
Some of you will.
That love is the character of God. That love does not whitewash justice. That love is the love of a parent, a perfect parent who looks at the child and says, you're wrong, you need to be disciplined. I love you dearly, I love you with everything I have, everything I have is yours, but you need to be corrected here. And that's the Jesus we're dealing with, who loves completely and desires what is true and right and just. They cannot be separated either. So to come to the New Testament and say that God is love and not speak anything else is heresy. To go to the Old Testament and say that God is just and not emphasize the love and grace he demonstrated in the Old Testament is heresy, because God embodies all of those attributes. He is all of those things. His love is what makes him just. His love is what gives us discipline when we need it. His love washes our feet when we're about to betray him. So we go from there. Jesus speaks a little bit more clearly to the disciples. There's one among you who's going to betray me. They begin looking around. Is it me? Is it me? Is it me? Who is it? They're getting a little nervous because Jesus knows something they don't know. And Jesus is the one who shares this bread with me, is the one who will betray me. So he gives it to Judas and says, go. Whatever you're going to do, get out of here. And it's not because he didn't know what it was. It's because he knew exactly what it was. And at that moment, Satan entered into the heart of Judas, Scripture says. Jesus had demonstrated love toward him just like he did everybody else. He offered him the way of salvation. He was the way of salvation. He showed him the truth, and yet Judas turned him away. Satan entered into his heart. He left the room. The other disciples, kind of confused like we would be, what's going on here? Did we forget to bring something to eat? Well, he's got the money. He'll take it. Jess and I have been married for 5.5 years, which some of you think is forever, and some of you think is, well, about 15 minutes. But anyway, in that period of time, she's learned a few things about me, and I've learned a few things about her. Not nearly as many as we'll know in a few more decades. And I'm not wishing the time to go by too quickly. I think we should enjoy life. One of the things she's learned is that when my sugar goes down, I get a little bit moody. But the mood only lasts for a few minutes. So as soon as my sugar goes back up, everything's great. Now I might not be the nicest person for 5 minutes, but once we get beyond that point, back to normal. Now on the other hand, I will say, not everybody's like that. Let me just put it that way. Some people hold on to things for a little bit longer, but for me it's 5 minutes. Why do I bring that up? She knows at this point, she didn't know this earlier, but she's figured out that if she can just ignore me for a few minutes, everything will be fine. She knows that already. Here we have Jesus and the disciples who've spent a lot of time together. They know each other. Jesus knows every little detail. He doesn't know the disciples the way we know each other. He knows every little detail. He knows the heart, he knows the mind, he knows everything about them, and he knows what Judas is going to do ultimately. And in that moment, he shows the love of God. I know I'm kind of hammering that pretty hard. There's an intent for that. And that intent is, if you and I are going to be like Christ, we will embody his complete love, not partial love. We're not going to love our spouses and our kids only. We're not going to love the people who love us. We are going to demonstrate the love of Christ to all. So think about the person that drives you up the wall. You absolutely hate being around them. You despise them. Who is that? Don't tell me. I don't want to know the name. But just get that in the forefront of your mind. And then remember that in the face of death, we have a Savior who expressed love to his to Judas, who ultimately had him murdered. Maybe I have somebody that hates me that much. I don't particularly care. I'm not getting worked up about it. But the people that hate me, the people I can't get along with, I still must love. Let's move forward from here. Judas goes out and does his thing. John 13:31. When he had gone out, Jesus said, now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will also glorify him glorify him at once. Children, I am with you a little while longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I tell you. 34, I give you a new commandment. What is it? Love one another. Just as I have loved you, you must also love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. This love is not something we choose on a daily basis. It's not something we think about. It is Christ himself. By testimony, we are the children of God. God's Spirit lives in us. Therefore, we must love. Should Christians have been known historically for people that love each other? It's not supposed to just be love here. Sorry, Mommy. I need a tissue. Not supposed to be love just here, although that's important. The love is supposed to go someplace else. It's supposed to go everywhere. Every place we go, whether it's work, home, that love is supposed to come through me. That love does not say, I love you for who you are and think you should stay there. That love is not the one who looks at the neighbor's house and sees the house is on fire at 3 o'clock in the morning, knows the guy's a heavy sleeper and says, he'll figure it out. Or, in my line of work, he mowed 5 feet of my grass this week. Now I'm mad at him. He'll figure it out. No. Now, regardless of if it's somebody that's despised, we have a couple of neighbors that hate each other, which I'm sure everybody does. And if the one house was on fire, I know without a doubt the other neighbor would not do anything about it. Would not call the fire company. Might even go throw some gas. They hate each other. In that place, if I knew the neighbor hated me that much, my job, my duty before Christ is to do as Christ would. The duty that Christ gave me is to keep his commandments. It's not just the love, but that's really the basis for it. It's what would he do every moment of every day. I am not supposed to be Mike. I'm supposed to be Jesus. When you look at me, you ought to see Jesus. You ought not to see me. When you look at somebody like Bobby, though, that gets a little hard. We're supposed to see Jesus in Bobby, too. On Elliot and Chris to keep you guys going later. We're supposed to let people see Christ in us. When anybody looks at me, they should know I'm a child of God because I have love for one another. 36. Lord, Simon Peter said to him, where are you going? And Jesus answered, where I'm going, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow later. And Peter, in his shyness, Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. And Jesus says, you will not. At least not yet. You're not ready. You're going to deny me 3 times. Deny knowing me 3 times before the rooster crows. Before tomorrow morning, you'll forget you ever knew me. And you're going to jump up and down, kick and scream, and tell everybody you don't know my name. And Peter, of course, and everybody else is looking around like, there's no way. On that basis, we come into 14. Jesus starts with, let not your heart be troubled. He just nails them. He just shows them that Jesus, or that Judas was going to betray him. He tells Peter, there's not a chance in the world you're going to be faithful to me at this point. You're not grown up yet. He's preached about his death for a couple of years, about the beatings, etc. They know all the details, they haven't put them together yet. And as they begin to put them together, Jesus says, do not let your heart be troubled. And what we see here is, yes, he's God and man, so he's kind of got an edge on us. But the lesson for us here is, in that place, he was still a man of peace. Yes, he loved us. Yes, he loved them. And when he knew he was facing the cross and he was in his last few hours, he was at peace. Christians, historically, have made a difference because in the last few moments when they're being murdered, they often are at peace. And that peace can come from no other place. The world does not know that peace. The world does not know love like that, but Jesus does. There's no other religion that knows peace and love like this. They can talk about it. And this probably shouldn't be on video, but maybe that's okay. Islam is preached as a religion of peace. It's an acts of violence, the murder, the hatred, did not come from Christ. Mm. They may have been pursued in the name of religion. There may have been some crazy people over the couple thousand years who thought they were doing God a favor, but that did not come from Christ. Absolutely did not. Jesus says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms, dwelling places, mansions," whatever your translation says, and frankly, I don't care what they are. Any of that stuff is better than here. If not, I would have told you, I'm going to prepare a place for you. If I go away and prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you to myself so that where I am, you may be also. You know the way where I'm going. And Thomas says, "No, we don't." And Jesus says, "Well, you should. You've been following me around for a few years." He's starting to get a little bit annoyed, I think. He says, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." He states it again just as clearly as he has for 3.5 years, how to see God face to face. And they're hopefully starting to get it here. "If you know me, you also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." And Philip says, "Lord, show us the Father." And Jesus says, "Are you guys blind? Are you stupid?" I'm paraphrasing a little bit now. Please forgive me. "Are you blind? Are you stupid? I've been standing in front of you for a few years. And I've been speaking to you the words that God gave to me, the truth. If you've seen Jesus, you've seen the Father. If you know Jesus' love, you know the love from the Father. If you know the forgiveness of Jesus, you know the forgiveness of the Father. How is it," Jesus asked the question, "how is it you can spend all this time with me and not realize where I came from?" They're still caught up in how amazing this guy is, and they've not connected the dots. They know their history. Or at least some of them do. They know what the prophecies have been. They know that Jesus connected the dots for them, and yet they're as stupid as we and have not God. Jesus is not that hard. "Here I am. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you know the Father, you know me." There's quite a few people that think my dad and I are identical. And, well, I'm younger, better looking. And I would tell him that, and he'd laugh about it. I'm right more of the time, all those things. We discuss it like that. But in the church, we've had quite a few people just think of us identically. And then they get surprised one day when they realize that I kind of have a brain of my own. We're similar. We are not identical. But if my dad wants to speak something to someone and wants it to be portrayed as his way, and he cannot do it, I'm the person he calls. Because I can speak the way he wants to communicate it. Jesus and God are the same. They're both God. They're different persons. No one is ever going to explain the Trinity perfectly. We're not doing that this morning. We'll move on from there. But Jesus and God are two persons of the Trinity. They are both God. Jesus conveys exactly the message the Father wants. "Believe me that I'm in the Father, and the Father is in me, otherwise believe because of the works themselves. I've performed miracles, you ought to know it from there. 12, I assure you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and he will do even greater works than these because I'm going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it so the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it." This obviously requires a relationship with God, and we know that. Spending time, the intimacy, the willingness to pray and ask and according to his will. That's all given. We get into 15 again. And this is the statement that keeps coming up in these chapters. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." It's in here at least 7 times. But I keep finding more than I missed. I found another one this morning that I hadn't seen where, "If you love me, you will keep my commands." Jesus continues. He'll ask the Father. He is going to leave, Spirit's going to come who indwells us, who's going to be more powerful, he's not more powerful than Christ, but he's going to be, the work he's going to do is going to be more significant than what Christ did because he's going to indwell. Regardless of where we are at any given point, the Spirit of God is in me and he's in you that causes us to embody the attributes of God. Jesus taught multitudes, and yet most walked away. That was all part of the plan. That may sound bad, but that was part of the plan. Jesus was not going to spend his 3.5 years of ministry dealing with people that did not care. He was not going to spend 3.5 years of ministry with people who would not grow, who would not receive Christ, except the one that betrayed. He invested his life into those that were willing to grow, mature, and build his kingdom. Those who were willing to be like him. Those who were willing to turn away from everything else. And that's the part of discipleship we don't like to talk about. We like the love part. We like the salvation part. We like to know that we're on our way to heaven. And yet, discipleship is not avoiding hell. Discipleship is turning away from everything else. That does not mean you don't get a job. That does not mean you don't have some place to live. But you don't focus on all that stuff. That is not your goal in life. Last I checked, you kind of need to work to pay your bills. Kind of handy, anyway. I guess there are other ways to do it, but in good conscience, I don't think we can. Either way, you turn your focus off of all of that onto the kingdom of God. You willingly give up all of that for the kingdom of God. You give up your ambitions for the kingdom of God. That does not mean you don't use your brain. It does not mean you don't use your heart, because God gave you those things and expects you to use. He expects us to use all of who we are for all of who he is. Discipleship is me turning over everything to Jesus Christ. And not just the good stuff. It's expecting that there's going to be some struggles to come. Jesus guaranteed it. He probably guaranteed it with a smile on his face. We'll get to that in a minute. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Verse 17, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. The world is unable to receive him because it doesn't see him or know him. But you do know him because he remains with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I am coming to you. Got to love these promises. The disciples are not getting this. They still think Jesus has come to free Israel from Rome and conquer and set up his kingdom. They haven't figured out all that out yet. But that's okay. They figured it out later at the appropriate time. Verse 21. The one who has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father. I will also love him and will reveal myself to him. Verse 22. Judas, this is not Judas Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it you are going to reveal yourself to us and not to the world? It shows their disconnect still. And Jesus answers, if anyone loves me, you're probably tired of hearing this. He will keep my word. He will keep my commandments. My Father will love him, and will come to him, and will make our home with him. The one who doesn't love me will not keep my commands. Wow, that's hard to figure out, isn't it? If you obey God, you love him. If you do not obey God, you do not love him. That generally is considered for believers and unbelievers, but let me tell you, really, what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with Jesus speaking to, we'll call them believers, for lack of a better term, way to put it. They're following him, they've committed themselves to him, and he looks at them and says, the one who obeys me will keep my commands. There's 11 of you here. Are you keeping my commands? Are you obeying? If you are not, it's evidence that you don't love. That does not mean we will never disobey. I'm a human being. I know that. You know that. We all disobey. I have 2 kids. Another one coming. They disobey. When we get into habitual sin, it's evidence that we do not love God. It tells the world Christianity is a joke. It tells the world Christ's sacrifice was not adequate. slap in the face of God. The one who loves me will keep my commandments. I've spoken these things to you while I remain with you, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, the Father, will send him in my name. He will teach you all things and remind you of everything.